than can't buy better than can't buy better than.
Good morning. Prime Minister Mulroney's massive majority Conservative government has been in power for almost 5 months now. Still a bit of a honeymoon. But what about Pat Carney? What was it Pat Carney said when she was tackled about the Petrofina deal a few weeks ago?
We don't know what's in there because we're not allowed to look. And, you know, it could be a bestseller. But I can't even take a peek at it.
I have many questions for the Honourable Pat Carney, Minister of Energy in the Conservative government, a senior cabinet minister from British Columbia, and one of them is going to be about Petrofina. But what about the other things? Why are gas prices still going up? What is happening in Ottawa? Why are there so many patronage appointments from this government which promised us a different way of filling these lovely, lush, Peola government jobs? That's topic number one this morning. Topic number two. We're going to have some detail from the Laborers' Union 602 on their new cut-rate contract for domestic housing, which seems to have upset the apple cart of the Building Trades Council and one Roy Gauthier. And then this morning we're going to demonstrate the highly efficient bureaucracy of Canada Post. If you live in the 4600 block of Woodrow and North Vancouver, you get mail. If you live in the 4700 block, you don't get mail. Reporter Mark Schneider takes it up with the post office.
You're the guy who's responsible to say who gets mail and who doesn't?
I'm responsible, correct.
And you've said these people here won't get mail delivered?
Not at this time. We're taking the matter up in Ottawa.
Even though right across the street they get mail delivered?
That's correct.
When you see it, you'll find it hard to believe. This house gets mail? This house doesn't. They've got to go down to general delivery, miles and miles and miles away. But off the top, and most importantly, the Honourable Pat Carney, one of the key cabinet ministers in the Mulroney government, still a knight or knights and knightesses in shining armour after the break. The Honourable Pat Carney, when your government when you were in opposition, you made many, many attacks on the Petrofina deal until the Petrofina deal stank to high heaven. Agreed?
Certainly.
Certainly. When you were questioned as a cabinet minister, you said, we can't look at the books. It might be a bestseller for all I know. And with all due respect, Pat, why can't the government of Canada, the Prime Minister especially, just say, I want to see these documents and then tell us what's in the documents which caused you in opposition to be so upset. On the Petrofina purchase for $1.6 billion, which added nothing to the oil capacity of this country and slapped up the pile of the price of gas with the ownership tax, etc.
Now, you've made so many editorial comments and you've asked so many questions, I don't even know where to start. But let's start with the first fact. I, as the Minister of Energy, don't have the documents. Our department, under the Liberals, was not involved in the Petrofina transaction. Petro-Canada and Bill Hopper, were the chairman of Petro-Canada, were the agent for the Crown. They did the deal. And I have asked Bill Hopper, at the Prime Minister's instructions, to bring all his documents to the Public Accounts Committee, which he will do. And I've also asked him to deliver all the documents he has to Ken Dye, the Auditor General, which he has done. Mr. Dye, I understand, has cartons and cartons of boxes, and our department shipped him everything that we had. So Mr. Dye has everything that we have, and presumably the Public Accounts Committee, when the House resumes sitting, will call Mr. Hopper before the accounts, and we'll find out something about this transaction.
So you're leaving it all to Dye and Hopper to tell the public what the Petrofina deal was when you attacked the Petrofina deal in spades when you were in opposition. And Mr. Nadeau...
Mr. Webster, you're much too good a journalist to ask such a disjointed question. I just told you, Bill Hopper was the agent who did the deal. Bill Hopper will come and appear before the Public Accounts Committee and say what happened. I mean, I wasn't even around then. I certainly wasn't the Minister of Energy. I have nothing to say to the
But haven't you looked to see what happened?
No. Now, there's where we come to the second issue.
Yes.
And you...
This is where I'm baffled.
As a good Scot, you know, in our system of government, in our parliamentary system of government, we have very strict conventions about who can go back and look up whose documents. I, as a cabinet minister, have got free access to the cabinet documents of my time. I can go back any time, even in the future. I can go back and look at the cabinet documents that relate to when I was a member of cabinet. I cannot go back and look at the cabinet documents of the last administration. There is a period of time while those documents are considered historic records before they are revealed. Now, you know that, the Mackenzie...
No, I didn't know that.
Yes, of course.
I thought if I was Prime Minister, I could say, show me the Petrofina deal. I want to find out if there was any insider trading or if there was a proper assessment made of the price of $1.6 billion before the Liberals paid the check.
I'm telling you that those documents are documents, if they exist at all, that are in Mr. Hopper's charge, and Mr. Hopper will take whatever he's got to the Public Accounts Committee. You keep confusing the idea of you know, what a department has and what the...
Cabinet has.
No, not the cabinet, but what Mr. Hopper and the Crown Corporation. What happened was very simple. The Prime Minister of the day and the cabinet of the day said, Bill Hopper, you go out, we want to make Petro-Canada the agent, you know, for this. You go out and you acquire companies. And that's what Mr. Hopper did. And he acquired Petrofina.
But he must have had an approval from the cabinet before he spent the money.
That's what we're going to have to wait and see in before the Public Accounts Committee. But I have, you know, I just don't have those documents in my department.
But the Prime Minister could look at them any time he wanted.
The Prime Minister can presumably look at what Mr. Hopper has any time he wanted, but, I mean, it'll be before the Public Accounts Committee. But it's not in our files.
See, hypothetically speaking, supposing, totally hypothetically, something dreadful went on in a previous administration, do we have to sit back under some civil service ruling that we can't look at the document to see if there were 10 members of the mafia in cabinet?
I should hope not. But, you know, there is a very good rationale for the idea that you cannot go rummaging around immediately in the administration that preceded you.
Why?
Because sometimes you don't know all the information at the time. And I think that there is the issue of cabinet secrecy. You know, there are cabinet minutes.
You couldn't find out what cabinet minister said to this cabinet minister about that.
Yeah, I mean, if I disagree with, say, Michael Wilson
Will Dye get enough information so that he can drop his lawsuit against you, which is currently on the go?
Since I don't know what information Mr. Hopper has, how can I answer that question? Presumably, Mr. Dye will get the information that he requires. I could also point out that I also, as minister, hired a private firm of chartered accountants, Ernst & Whinney, to do a separate audit of Petro-Canada as soon as I assumed office. And the reason for that was that if we were going to be involved in a long and lengthy legal hassle with the Auditor General, I was worried that we might never find out what happened about Petrofina for a long time to come. So I hired a separate firm of auditors. Mm. They have certainly had access to all the information that Mr. Dye has got.
And
they will be reporting to me at the end of the month. And actually, it will be their report, which serves as the sort of the basic document for the Public
Accounts
Committee.
But you have ordered Hopper to cooperate in every way with Kenneth Dye.
The Prime Minister asked me to do that, and I have done that. And Mr. Hopper certainly is cooperating.
You reappointed him, and you're continuing his job. He stays in at $414,000 a year, I see.
Mr. Hopper's appointment is at pleasure. And he is the chairman of Petro-Canada. He is to go to the Public Accounts Committee in probably January, February. His appointment ran out on December the 14th. What would you have done, Mr. Webster?
Well, I'm not a cabinet minister. But I understand that you were very tough and that you told Hopper to get every member of the board of Petro-Canada to sign a resignation in advance in case you want to kick them out. Is that correct?
Well, it is clear that as the representative of the taxpayers of Canada, who are the owners of Petro-Canada, that we would want to have new directors on the board of Petro-Canada.
That's good.
Right? And therefore, we made it clear that we would appreciate the resignations of those directors who held political appointments.
To be used by you when you feel it's appropriate.
And we've already done that. The Prime Minister announced the new directors of Petro-Canada before Christmas.
But the Petrofina tax is going to stay on our gasoline.
Yes. Now, I opposed that at the time, but I'll tell you the real basic problem is we don't have another $1 billion right now. I mean, we're running a huge deficit. The Petrofina tax brings in $800 or $900 million a year, and until we get our finances in better shape where we can see where we can cut that tax, we're pretty well stuck with it.
The price of gasoline just went up in Vancouver. Is it going to continue to go up?
The government sets the wellhead price, the producer price of gasoline. We do not set the market price. I mean, there's no way that the government intervenes and says that the price of gasoline in Vancouver will be this or that. But I can talk more about that. But basically, we are going to be very close to world prices, and it's our policy to go completely to world prices. So I don't see where the market forces would come to increase it.
Will we be paying more in Canada for gasoline than the world price? We're paying $2.50 a gallon right now on the West Coast.
World price relates to the price of crude oil. That's the OPEC price in the...
Let me put it simply, as you would have done when you were a reporter. Is there any hope of gas price being cut in the foreseeable future under the Conservative government of Carney and Mulroney?
Yes, if two things happen. If we could find other revenue sources, because more than about half the price of a gallon of gasoline or a liter of gasoline is taxes. And I knew you'd ask that, so I dug them out. In Vancouver, for instance, gasoline is selling about 50 cents a liter. And of that amount, the federal government gets 15%, the provincial government gets 27%, yeah, and the industry only gets slightly over half of the percent. So when people ask me, why is it that Canadians are paying more than Americans for gasoline, you know, one of the simple answers is that we tax it more. And the reason that we tax it more is we have such a huge deficit that we're trying to, we're stuck with some of these revenue sources until such time as we can bring the deficit under control.
More with Pat Carney, the Tory MP for Vancouver Centre. The woman is going to have the criminal code amended to clear the streets permanently.
Right.
After the break. All through the Liberal regime, the Western taxpayers were subsidizing oil imports to Ontario. When will you stop that?
As soon as we can reach agreement with the producing provinces, which will be sometime in the next few weeks. What we want to do is get away from the incredibly complex pricing apparatus that the National Energy Program set in place, which created, if you can believe it, 81 different prices for oil. And, you know, people are subsidizing other people within this great complex system. We want to simplify it. We want to say that we're going to go to world price. The market will determine what the price is. We'll buy and sell and import oil just like we do other commodities. And
when that happens, therefore, Alberta oil will find its own level at the world price.
Yes.
And Ontario users will pay for the oil that comes from Venezuela.
Yeah. Do you realize now we have a system where we have new old oil, and then we have, another kind of old oil, and then we have synthetic oil prices. It's incredible.
Well, so, how long will it take you to clear up this complicated mess?
In our discussions with the producing provinces, once we agree how to do it, it won't take long. It should only take a matter of 2 or 3 months.
But with oil at world prices, there's little you can do, am I correct, in, say, boosting the oil industry in Alberta. Is there any prospect of a boom in Alberta or in BC for natural gas?
We've already helped the natural gas situation in BC when we changed the gas pricing policy to export more gas to the U.S. at more flexible prices. That really helped boost our natural gas sales and either maintained or created about 15,000 new jobs. So we will continue in the direction of trying to increase our gas exports to the U.S. because we have so much gas.
Your friend Stephen Rogers has his hand out for $500 or $600 million to build a new natural gas pipeline to Vancouver Island. Are you going to give the provincial government any money for this job creation program?
I'm talking about that with Stephen Rogers, who's currently on holiday. But we have discussed that in our negotiations, and I have said, and he accepts the fact, that we certainly don't have that kind of money in this year's fiscal framework, to use our term. It's just not there. But if they can produce a more economic line, I mean, they want the federal government to pay 50% of their operating deficit at a time when they're going to sell the gas below the cost that they're going to buy it at.
Stupid deal.
That's not a very attractive deal for a federal government. So we've asked them to take another look at the actual figures, and that we'll try and slot that project in the upcoming years.
An American water expert yesterday says that depth charges will be transferred to COMOX in any immediate threat of nuclear war. 32 nuclear depth charges to be used by NATO anti-submarine aircraft to blow up Soviet subs. Are you aware? I thought your policy was no nuclear weapons in Canadian soil.
Right. And I sit on the cabinet committee that deals with that. That has never been discussed in cabinet. So it certainly couldn't be cabinet policy. And I think really it's just one of various war game scenarios that some of the people in the Pentagon think up.
It's not something you think is an actual fact in an agreement between Canada and the United States.
I have no reason to think so.
All right,
it's never been discussed.
Let's get down. What about the deals, offshore oil deals, though? Bill Daniels of Shell is anxious, as I recall, to drill for oil up in the Hecate Straits. You are conducting a deal, negotiations with Pickford for the Hibernia oil field. Are the provinces anywhere close in coming to an amicable agreement with you on sharing oil revenues offshore?
Yes, in terms of the Atlantic Accord, where in terms of the Atlantic area, where Nova Scotia has found natural gas and where oil reserves have been found off Hibernia, yes, we either have agreements or we are negotiating agreements.
Well, that was your secret deal that you made during the campaign, was it?
No, nothing secret about it at all. It was done with great fanfare and a lot of flourish and a lot of signings ceremonies between now Prime Minister Brian Mulroney and Premier Peckford. There was nothing secret about it at all. Newfoundland thinks it's wonderful. In terms of BC, of course, it's different. There hasn't been any oil finds like that, so there's no basis to form an agreement. And not much interest at this point in doing it either, because it's a long way down.
One final question on Petrofina. Was that deal a scandal?
I'm dying to find out. No one will be watching the Public Affairs Committee, Public Accounts Committee, with more interest than me.
All right, now. Down to business.
Was that just the first go-round?
What do you mean?
What do you mean, down to business? Was that just the sparring?
That's
warm-up
right.
Match?
Yeah.
When do we get into the
real stuff?
Real stuff.
Right now.
Okay.
Are you going to amend the criminal code to make simple soliciting an offence in the West End and elsewhere in Canada?
Certainly.
Have you got such a commitment?
Of course.
This is a promise?
Yes, of course.
You're not going to mess around like the Liberals did or McGuigan did. You're actually going to amend the criminal code to make simple soliciting an offence so that prostitutes can be arrested and customers can be arrested.
Yes.
But what about the women? What about the feminists who say you're harassing these poor creatures?
Well, they will have an opportunity, I suppose, when the bill goes to committee to try and make their case. You know, we're a very democratic party. The bill will be introduced, hopefully sometime in the spring. It will go to committee, and that point will be heard. But, you know, it's interesting that it's tragic that support for anti-soliciting measures grows as the problem grows. You know, when it was only in the West End, only the West Enders cared about it. Now that it's in Mount Pleasant people are starting to get worried. Now that it's spread to Halifax and the injunction didn't hold, my heavens, you know, the MPs from Halifax are just as strong for that, you know, for bringing in anti-soliciting measures as I am. It's a problem that affects all the major cities. And it was a campaign commitment, and the legislation is being worked on. The Justice Minister, John Cosby, has said that out of fairness to the Fraser Committee, which was set up by the Liberals to look at that, he would wait till Christmas when they were supposed to deliver their report. If they haven't delivered their report, he committed to me that he would proceed. So I'm expecting
early action. So we don't have to worry about Sven Robinson and the NDP's plan to open whorehouses in Western Canada.
You have to worry about that. I don't.
More with Pat Carney after the break. The biggest laugh of your new government, Ms. Carney, has been your Prime Minister's gyrations on sacred trust, the sacred trust of universality. How much are you going to chop away at the universal benefits so widely accepted and desired by Canadians? Was that just campaign double talk, the sacred trust of universality?
You know, why are you and the opposition parties so spooked about talking about ways to deliver more money to people who need it? We have always said that universality, which is a word that means that all Canadians benefit somewhat from the system, from the benefits we have, we've always said that will be intact. But we are asking Canadians to debate and discuss how we might improve the system. And it's not that new. Because since 1976, as you sit there, you know, swallowing air, since 1976, the Liberal government brought in about 8 different changes to those programs. Don't you remember that? They cut family allowances without consultation. They de-indexed old age pensions without consultation. They changed the child tax credit without consultation. They did all that, and nobody said boo. Now we're saying, we have this system, we want to improve it, we want to get more money to people who need it, let's talk about ways to do it. And everyone, you know, you and the opposition parties are, you know, are prisoners of the status quo.
Don't you know why, Ms. Carney? Because it was your Prime Minister who said, most unlikely for a Conservative leader, I have a sacred trust of universality. And after he says that, Wilson cuts his throat, because it's quite obvious that what you're going to do is you're going to cut the family allowances from certain grades of people. But what, we know that. But we don't know if you're going to tighten up on unemployment insurance, be a real Scrooge, include pension payments and severance payments before you draw UIC. We don't know if you're going to actually tax away old age pensions.
Well, we know we're not going to tax away old age
from certain people.
I think if you thought about it, you know, that probably happens now. I mean, Margaret Mitchell in the NDP has advocated that as a way of recapturing tax.
No.
Don't you pay back more in tax than you get in old age pension?
No, I pay back 50% of my old age pension. In fact, if you take your overall income.
That's all you pay back?
You don't seem to understand this.
Don't you think you might want to give up the other 50%? You know, to your poor agent.
When you give up your indexed MP's pension, which...
We already took a pay cut.
You took a pay cut.
We took a 10% pay cut January the 1st of this year.
Oh, too bad. You're down to 110,000.
And Brian Mulroney, the Prime Minister, took a 15% pay cut.
He took 9,000
And you don't even notice. But if you're unwilling to give up your 50% share of your pension and your income bracket, if you're unwilling to do that, Jack, and to give it to the poor senior citizen aged 60 to 65 trying to live on $400 a month, if you are unwilling to make that concession, then all you have to do is say so.
That's
because what we're doing is asking people to talk about it.
By a politician, your attitude. But I'm trying to get you to understand that it was your Prime Minister who said the sacred trust of universality.
And we are still maintaining that universality is sacred and will be maintained.
No, you're going to cut it.
Medicare. Oh, why don't you wait and find out what we're proposing? And then you can comment on it. What is wrong?
Michael Wilson says you're going to cut it.
What is wrong about debating?
Nothing.
What is wrong about saying we have a universal system?
Why didn't he say that during the campaign?
But we're not saying anything different.
But why not during the campaign?
Why don't you let me talk? You know, we have a system of universality, and it's never been that everyone got the same benefits. Right now, some people get more benefits than others, okay? But that doesn't mean the system isn't universal. We're saying now we want to improve this system so we deliver more money to people who need it. And I sit in my constituency
Admirable.
Office. Okay.
Admirable.
And then we're saying, now, please, Canadians,
has my
tell
total
us some
support
idea.
If just you we're hadn't told us a pack of nonsense during the campaign.
It's not nonsense. We said it's a sacred trust. We still say it's a sacred trust. But we're talking about how you deliver it.
It's universality for some.
It's always been universality for some. And some people got more than others.
Agreed.
And now we want
that should
to know,
be taken away.
Yeah, and now we want to say, if people get more than others, please let's make sure it's the Canadians who need it and desire it. And most Canadians are willing to do that.
Of course they are.
All this huffing and puffing and wringing of anguished hands certainly isn't the case of the average Canadian who knows that they're, you know, that what we're trying to do is to make sure that people who need more get more and that people like yourself who don't need it maybe get less. Fair is fair.
entirely agree with you. Just the point that you didn't tell us the truth during the campaign.
Yes, we did tell you the truth. We said it was...
Michael Wilson didn't think you told us the truth.
Michael Wilson was one of the players who are trying to get the debate started.
Never mind. Tell me your new system of independent assessment for people prior to patronage appointments. Remember, during the campaign, we were told that
this?
The stench of patronage would never appear in the Conservative government and that there'd be a new way of selecting and appointing people to patronage appointments.
Well, I think that the Prime Minister has already indicated a marked change in attitude on that. He appointed Stephen Lewis, a good NDPer, ambassador to the United Nations, a token appointment. I mean, you got to be kidding.
He emasculated Stephen Lewis by that very clever appointment.
Jeffrey Pearson. Head of the Peace Institute, the son of the former Prime Minister. Excellent idea. Okay.
And you've forgotten one, Francis.
Lloyd Francis, a wonderful man, impeccable man, perfect choice as ambassador to Portugal. Now, you know, if we're giving out appointments to Liberals and we're giving out appointments to NDP, is there, in your view, no room for we poor Tories? I mean, do we have to still stand in line?
No, I'm convinced that you will appoint every Tory who needs a job to a job in due course. And at the moment, you've appointed 1.5% non-Tories.
The Liberals never left us that many appointments to make. All those boards are still stuffed with Liberals. Some of them sit there for 21 years.
We expect better from you.
Well, you've got better from us.
They were a bunch of rascals.
Well, who would you rather have? Eugene Whelan or Lord Francis? Or what? Bryce McAsee? Who would you think? Who would you rather have?
You tried to get me to campaign for a job for Bryce McAsee. Now, I'm merely saying...
Now, who would you rather have as ambassador to Portugal?
Pat Carney.
Who's a better choice?
Erwin Swangard.
Erwin Swangard? What about Taiwan?
I'm merely saying... that you are the ones who set the new standard and you don't seem to be following it.
And we did. We have made a lot of non-political appointments, but in cases where, like in Petro-Canada, where we want to make sure that the board, which reflects a company, which is owned by the government, is going to be receptive to the policies of the government.
What do you think?
That's only fair.
What do you think of your big, your ad agency of choice, one of the officials saying that some of the money from the commissions would go to the Conservative Party in Quebec?
I know nothing about that.
Oh, you missed that one?
No, I just...
Harvey Andre, I should add now, denied that such takes place, but a statement was made by one of the ad principals that some of the money was going to go to the province, to the Conservative Party in Quebec.
No, I know nothing about that. That certainly isn't true for the advertising budget of Energy, Mines and Resources, which has been frozen pending more cuts. You know, what you don't notice is that I have already cut in my department on November the 8th. I already cut $888 million from my budget. 25% of my budget I cut. The average cut in November the 8th was about 3%, and I cut nearly a quarter of my overall budget.
How many jobs were lost by that $880 million cut you made?
It's hard to determine it's hard to determine the overall impact because some of them will be in the private sector as we phase out the chip grants and the off-oil programs, it won't be so much a job loss as jobs will shift over to the private sector. And also in our own department, we have said that anyone who is displaced as a program ends will be have priority in hiring. So I can't really tell you what the overall cuts will be, but of course there will be.
A couple of thousand.
No, nothing like that.
I give up on Pat Carney. Your turn to have at Pat Carney, Minister of Energy, after the break. When do you go back to Ottawa, Pat?
We have cabinet meetings next week, so I'll be back for those.
Go ahead to the Tory Energy Minister.
Good morning, Ms. Carney and Mr. Webster.
Good morning.
Question for Ms. Carney. When the House convenes in Ottawa, I'm not quite sure when the House gets back together, but exactly what is the new government's position in regards to putting the oil prices back at a world oil price level? Thank you.
Well, there's two questions there. First of all, the House goes back officially, the Parliament resumes sitting on January the 21st, a week from Monday. When we actually go to world prices for oil will be determined in the current round of negotiations that I'm doing with the Western producing provinces. Those are underway now. I mean, we met before Christmas, we'll meet this month, and we should have a date for that close to the end of the month.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning, Mr. Webster and Mrs. Carney.
Good morning.
I wanted to bring up something that I have thought of for quite some time. It's the fact that I have worked for 32 years and unfortunately have been unemployed for the last two, which would make 34 years of employment, that I would be contributing to the system. I am a single woman, and I'm on welfare now, which is absolutely desperate straits. My rent has just been increased to $370 a month, and I get $375 a month. Could there not be a system introduced of graduated income to the numbers of years that you have contributed to the system to at least make a viable income when you're in desperate straits to pay for your food and your rent and accommodation and transportation and whatever?
Well, you see, that's exactly the kind of positive idea that we want Canadians to put forward and we can debate. I mean, yes, I see that that is, you know, something that is should be explored.
How old are you, ma'am?
I'm 50.
Right, 50. I mean, you know, you and I are in that category. I'm in my late
40s. You promised homemakers pensions during the campaign, and now you can't afford them.
Yes, but we will phase them in. But, I mean, you know, women in our age category who are unemployed are probably in one of the worst job pictures in our economy. I mean, we really are in probably the worst position of anyone, except maybe the very young, unskilled, unemployed person.
Yes.
And we have to be able to develop a safety net which helps us.
And you ain't got it now. Go ahead, please.
Yes, a belated happy Hogmanay to you both. Jack, it's knights in shining armor and ladies in flowing gowns.
Thank you.
Okay, I have 2 points. One, the Auditor General of this beautiful country of ours should be able to go into any facility of the government's business and crown corporations or whatever to audit them. If he requires more people, he should have more people to do that. Every Crown Corporation should be audited every year.
Well, he's trying to do that on a selective basis, but don't you think Carney's fulfilling her function by giving the documents to Hopper to give to, or Hopper to
yes.
die?
I mean, he's getting the documents he requires.
Definitely. In fact, she's doing an excellent job.
Thank you. Enough
Thank
of
you.
That. Go ahead, please.
Yeah. Good morning, Jack. I'd like to address my question to Pat Carney.
Right.
Go ahead.
Yeah. I'm wondering what your government in its proposed changes to the criminal code will do to the Johns who harass the residents of the neighborhoods where the prostitutes are operating. I formerly lived in the West End, and we moved away from there because my girlfriend was harassed by Johns who are cruising for prostitutes.
Do you know the
yes.
details of the amendments to the code yet?
No, I don't know, but they'll be very similar to the Justice Committee recommendations. You know, augmented by some very good information from the government of BC and the government of Nova Scotia, and maybe even by the Fraser Commission. But yes, of course, one of the basic objectives of the legislative change is that the Johns will be charged too. The basic idea is that it will be an offense to offer for sale or to purchase sexual services.
On the street. Go ahead, please. Hello.
Morning.
Good
morning.
That's you.
I went over to the United States border and saved $17 on one fill of gas on Monday. This I did for the first time, and I'm wondering why you won't sell Petrofina back to the private sector.
Good question.
Well, because they're not related.
Petro-Canada, he's talking about.
Yes, no, he said Petrofina back to the private sector.
Cost him $17 on one fill crossing the border
yeah,
into
but
the States.
Selling Petrofina's got nothing to do with that. As I've explained, the reason gas prices are higher in Canada is that both the provincial government and the federal government takes a big chunk, much more than the oil producers get, in taxes. And until we change that system, and we're hoping to change that system when we can afford to, we will be paying at the pump higher prices than the Americans.
So he should continue to go down to the States and save $17 on every fill.
If with exchange rates and gasoline prices, etc., it's in his interest. Of course, that's what bothers the oil companies, and that's one of the reasons why the retail gasoline companies have price wars and try and cut the prices is because they don't want you going down to the States.
They always seem funny to me, these price wars.
No, it depends where you live in the country. The price wars in Ontario and Montreal are very,
go ahead,
very
please.
Good. I mean, you know.
Go ahead, please.
Good deals for consumers.
Yeah, I would just like to ask Ms. Carney, what she thinks would happen if we dropped the federal taxes on gasoline at the pump to about 50% of what they are now,
And also, could you possibly tell me how many jobs she thinks were lost when they canceled the CHIP program? Thanks.
We didn't cancel the CHIP program. We phased it out. We're phasing it out over time. We've reduced the amount of the grant, and we are going to be ending it in 1986. That's because that program is pretty well mature. It's done its purpose, which is to convince Canadians that it's energy efficient and in their economic interest to insulate their homes. The industry worked with our department in determining how we were going to make that transition, and the expectation is that the industry will continue as a very viable industry, and people will that will still be a major employment area.
Another segment of phone calls with Pat Carney after the break. Northern viewers will be mad at me if I don't ask you about what's going to happen in the Beaufort.
Well, hopefully the oil and gas industry will continue drilling in the Beaufort. It looks very promising as Northerners...
It's too dear to get the oil out, isn't it?
No, it depends on the volume. You know, if you find something big enough, then you can afford to ship it out. And the Beaufort probably looks better now than it has for some time. So,
are you going to, on the National Energy Program, are you going to take away, or have you already taken away this horrifying business where everybody's got to give 50% of their fine to Petro-Canada?
That's not an accurate statement, Mr. Webster.
Close.
No.
How much do you have to give now if you make a fine? How much do you have to give back to Petro-Canada?
I don't think you have to give anything back to Petro-Canada, but there is a provision for a crown share.
Which 50%.
But by the government of Canada, not by Petro-Canada particularly. The problem with that is the government of Canada has to pay for that share, and there isn't enough billions and billions of dollars in our treasury to do it.
So
we're going to replace the system with something that makes a little more sense.
That'll make it much more attractive to the Americans.
No, we are still committed. Our party has always been committed to increased participation by Canadians in the energy field. We've always been committed since John Diefenbaker, in the 70s, it was enunciated by John Diefenbaker in policy in the 1970s on that 50% of our oil and gas industry must be owned by Canadians. And that's the stipulation I asked the industry to meet.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning, Jack and Pat.
Good morning.
After 6 years of service, you are going to be getting a pension. And a couple minutes ago, you were asking for positive suggestions.
Okay,
after 6 years, you're eligible for this pension. Why don't you wait till age 60 till you start receiving it? I'm going to put down the phone so I can watch and listen to you on the TV there.
At the time that the Prime Minister announced that we were going to take pay cuts, cabinet members would take pay cuts, he also announced that there would be a review of the pension plan for parliamentarians. And I'm certain that that will be one of the elements that will be reviewed.
Did he not mention that he would look very closely at the present automatic indexing of the pensions?
Oh, yes. I mean, we've always been very...
Because we've got old Liberal cabinet ministers who, when they're 65, pick up pensions of $200,000 a year, as of this moment.
Well, not that I know of, because...
That was a calculation made for Bassford, by the time he picked up the inflation factor after so many years.
Well, the pension depends on the position of each MP, and there's no way I would know that.
But indexing of pensions automatically for MPs when ordinary people don't get it is not fair, is it?
No, it's not fair, and also it is a disincentive for MPs to oppose inflation. I mean, if you know that your pension is going to be indexed, and our pension is not indexed, I think, until you're 60 or 65, the MP's pension isn't indexed until 60 or 65.
But then you have a catch-up provision.
But I don't even qualify for a pension yet, so I really don't know much about pensions. But I can assure you, the Prime Minister has said that we are going to be reviewing the pension scheme.
Go ahead, please.
Good morning. Ms. Carney, what are your intentions of doing towards the municipal transit levy tax, the 250? I'll wait your answer.
That's a provincial government levy tax. It's not federal at all. Go ahead, please.
Yes, on the subject of other sources of revenue, I think we're all aware, you know, the problems associated and generated by the use of alcohol. Yet the government continues to sell it, and I think they make a nice healthy profit on it. So I've got a bit of a hypothetical suggestion for you. Just suppose that marijuana were to be legalized.
Oh, just a minute. Are you going to legalize marijuana?
It's not on my list of priorities.
Why don't you answer the question?
I said I have, you know, it's not on my list of priorities.
Is it the policy of the Conservative government to legalize marijuana? Why don't you get rid of all these normal cooks?
It's just, you know, considering the fact that our cabinet discussions center on unemployment and jobs and getting money to people who need it and dealing with the woman who gets $350 a month and pays $375 in rent, that's what we spend our time discussing. And some of these other elements are just going to have to wait until we can get
in
around
to it. In fact, it was a stupid question, was it not?
That's no one who listens to you or watches you on TV is stupid, Jack. I mean, after all, do I have to do your PR for you?
I get news for you, some of them are. Go ahead, please.
Hello. May I ask Mrs. Carney a couple of questions, please?
Yes.
As she's well aware of being the energy minister, she must know that the difference between the synthetic price of oil in Alberta
right.
against the world price of oil and the spot price of oil.
Right.
Now, what is the difference? In cases, we are paying more than the world price of oil right now, where you can buy it at the spot market cheaper.
Right. The point that you're making is that under the present system, there are a whole lot of different prices for oil. Synthetic, spot, world, old oil, new oil, heavy oil, light, medium, crude oil. And rather than give you a very complex answer, we're trying to get a much more simple pricing regime where everyone pays roughly the same.
Go ahead, please.
As a tax-paying citizen, I fully agree with the appointing of conservatives to the various positions. It's an extension of what the people voted for, the good government they voted for.
Yeah. That's a very good point, because often as a minister, you know, we will set policy and the cabinet will agree to policy, because remember, I have to take my policy initiatives to cabinet and have them approved or agreed to. But that doesn't make any sense, or it's not enough, unless there are people in place who will implement that policy. And I know one of the problems the Joe Clark administration had was that the policy never left the minister's desk because it just was ignored. And one way that you can make sure that the policies are implemented is by making sure that you have people...
Like-minded people.
They don't have to be political Tories, but they have to be like-minded people on the boards.
And don't be so simple-minded with all due deference and respect. What we're getting at is that the Liberals left behind an incredible stench of disgusting patronage. Would that be a correct opinion?
That's certainly the prevailing opinion, and it is my opinion.
Is that your opinion? Yes.
But I do not ask people to produce their membership cards before I appoint them to a board.
You're merely pointing out that Mr. Mulroney said he was going to have a new system of vetting, perhaps before committees of the House of Commons, key people.
Yes.
We haven't seen any of them yet, although we've seen hundreds of routine Tory appointments dished out.
But he said the magic word is key people, and we haven't appointed many key people right now, except for Stephen Lewis, the ambassador to the UN, and people like that.
Oh, that was crafty.
It was sound.
Oh, it was sound and crafty.
And a responsible act by a responsible Prime Minister of Canada.
And it certainly, you know, took the stench of any patronage from the successive appointments, because he appointed an NDPer
But there has been no stench with other appointments. I mean,
not
new
yet.
Name. Tell me what is wrong with any of our appointments.
I could find a couple, but not yet.
No, I'd love to know who they are.
I mean,
they're very carefully vetted, and most of the appointments are to the kind of, you know, the Weights and Measures Act or something.
So any old Tory can fill these jobs. I'm merely making the point that you've got to avoid in the future a Liberal-type stench.
But we are avoiding it. That's the commitment of the Prime Minister.
Can we wait and see?
Except, yeah.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, why don't we sell off the Crown corporations?
Yeah.
We'll pay off the national debt. We won't be paying this interest. And then pass a law that we cannot have anything but a balanced budget in the future.
Yes. We are looking at various Crown corporations to sell off to the private sector. And we've actually made the decision to sell some. But those are cabinet decisions, and I don't know whether they've been announced yet. But that is definitely the route we're going.
My thanks to Pat Carney. This has been our preliminary canter for your first interview in office, and it has been delightful. You've been aggressive, perceptive, learned, well-informed.
That's more than I can say for you, because it's my second interview since I was appointed to office.
It's not. It's your first.
No, it's my second.
When was the first?
Well, we'll argue this later. The day after.
On the air. Oh, that was only a PR handout. My thanks to Pat Carney. Next, we're going to turn to a tough little story involving Raleigh Garden. of the Laborers Union Local 602, which has signed an agreement with the CLRA to cover domestic house, wood frame apartment buildings, and which is being denounced by his colleagues in the trade, brethren in the trade union business, as a kind of yellow dog contract. And we'll have at Mr. Rowley Gordon after the break. The economic situation in British Columbia has made it very tough for unions. There has been considerable resistance to any form of wage cuts. Rowley Gordon, the business manager of the Laborers Union, Local 602, which is part of the building, BC and Yukon Building Trades Council, is that right?
That's correct, Jack.
You've signed an agreement with CLRA for a specific type of work. What type of work is that?
Residential construction, Jack. It consists of four-story wood frame apartments and under townhouse developments, row housing, condominium projects, all wood frame.
Now, this is work which you have not had before, am I correct? This is a new area of employment for you.
That's correct. It's non-union, almost 100%.
So therefore, you've signed this agreement with CLRA for what reason? So you can, union contractors can bid for these jobs?
That's absolutely correct. And put our non-union, our out-of-work people back to work.
How many out-of-work people have you got in the Laborers Union?
In my local, 50% of the construction people are out of work for the second year in a row.
How many would that be in terms of numbers?
In my local, that's 2,000. In the building trades, it's half of 50,000.
Now, you've signed, first of all, how much of a wage cut have you taken in domestic as compared to the other construction work?
Well, about 25% across the board. But let's get one thing straight, Jack. This has no reflection on the construction industry per se today. There is not one member of any union out there that will have to take a cut on the work he's doing right now. If he wants to go into residential construction rather than sit home and collect unemployment insurance, he'll have to work for the rates that are competitive in that industry.
And what are the rates in the agreement that you have signed with the CLRA for, let's call it, wood frame construction?
The lowest rate, hourly rate, is $12 an hour plus the 8% holiday pay, which is another 96 cents. You're looking at a guy that's taking home $518 a week gross pay.
Are you telling me the lowest rate is $12 an hour?
The lowest rate is $12 an
hour. I've seen reports that the lowest rate was $8.70 an hour. That's not true.
That's untrue. Untrue. The lowest rate is $12 an hour. There's a student's rate for the summer months of $9 an hour, which only applies on a ratio of 2 students for every 10 on the crew. So you're only looking from May to September to put the owner's son to work. I mean, he provides the job, so you have to do something.
Right now, there are other, before I get to that though, what would the lowest rate be in 602's CLRA construction be?
$17.25 an hour.
$17.25 an hour, plus fringe benefits.
Oh yes, lots of fringe benefits.
So this is going to be $12 an hour plus lesser fringe benefits.
That's right, $1.35 versus $1.89.
All right, now, what prospects have you got of getting people to work in this wood frame building union? Because you will work for that, but the other unions won't work for cut rates, will they?
When they start to talk to their membership, they will. You had a fellow from the UA here, who we both know, Norm Farley,
right,
who ran on the ticket of providing a residential agreement at cut rates.
That's correct. He did do that.
The painters are indicating that they are interested because they have the high unemployment situation. I understand the plasterers have a memorandum of agreement with the CLRA on the same basis.
So you're the first one to come out front and center on this.
Yeah, kind of dumb, aren't I?
Yeah, Gauthier has been flipping his gasket all over the place, so saying, this is damnable, I'm going to go to court, I'm going to go to labor, they can't do this, they've broken the deal with CLRA. Have you made an improper deal with CLRA?
Absolutely not, Jack. I stood up 2 years ago in front of my peers and said, look, we have a problem. We're acting like dinosaurs. If we don't start to address the economics of the situation in the construction industry, we're going to go down the tube. We now have 50% employment. Some of them have 80% unemployment. I'm trying to draw to their attention. We have to make drastic changes. Now, the non-union people who are now doing 60% of the high-rise work in the province of British Columbia came out of that residential construction area. Let's go right back into where they come from and beat them at their own game.
In other words, you're saying that you're now losing the formal construction jobs to non-union people who've been gaining great experience in the other jobs.
That's right, using our out-of-work people.
So Gauthier is full of wind when he says you've done something improper or illegal or against the CLRA agreement.
Well, I'm not noted to be a conformist. Gauthier, who I have the greatest respect for, resigned from the Labor Board. I wrote him a letter and told him I was opposed to that. I and two other people have been appointed to the Labor Board. There are a number of things that have got him upset. But I think what I'm trying to emphasize to the rest of the building trades is if we don't do something for our members, we should quit collecting our paychecks.
True enough. Now, have your members voted on this contract?
No, they'll be doing that tonight. There'll be, it'll be going to our general meeting, and it'll be discussed in full. It'll be going to our executive board this afternoon. We're going to recommend we move ahead, but we are also going to recommend that we hold it in abeyance until we see whether the other trades are in fact going to come along with us, go down to the CLRA, and negotiate a trade-wide, an industry-wide agreement.
You're going to hold this in reserve to see if a trade-wide agreement can be negotiated?
Absolutely.
And if it can't, will you go ahead?
Well, I have no choice.
But that raises a point. Are you and the Laborers' Union prepared to do total construction on a wood frame building without other trades?
We have indicators that there are other trades out there that will supply us with people, Jack.
Who can join your union?
Absolutely.
That's the loophole, isn't it?
That is a loophole, yes.
Hey, now let's go through what our old friends in the Carpenters Union say about you.
They say lots of things.
Your ears must have been burning when you read this. No job security. Return to job site hiring instead of hiring through the hiring hall.
But what it says in the collective agreement, everybody has to have a clearance slip from the hiring hall.
So that's wrong.
Certainly it's wrong.
Employers can hire non-union workers in preference to unemployed union members, and the union cannot prevent it.
Absolutely not.
Not true.
Not true.
Employers will regain complete power to hire and fire at will.
Well, I kind of think they have that now. I mean, if a guy doesn't perform, he's going to be laid off. We have all the provisions under the normal agreements are there.
Is there a non-affiliation clause in this contract?
Absolutely, but it's interesting to note that there are a number of trades that work on non-union jobs as a matter of course, and they do not invoke their non-affiliation clause. And joint committee to decide these things before we get into. You've got to understand that this is an initial agreement. The second year of the wage package hasn't even been negotiated yet.
So you can work beside non-union people if you want to, as is presently being done in the industry.
That's right.
Cuts to health and welfare and pension benefits. Yes, down from $1.89 to $1.35.
That's right, but the coverage is essentially going to be very close to the same.
Holiday pay cut from 12% to 8%.
You have to be competitive, Jack.
The work week increased to 40 hours.
Yes, and we had no problem with that. The guys want to go out and make some money. The end result of working a 40-hour week at a lesser rate is you take almost the same amount of money home because the tax gets you.
Yeah. I'll take calls to Rolly Gordon now and continue my interview with him. I've just got one sizable section with him before I've got to do Schneider's post office, but after the break. A couple of things I want to get clear. We're talking about the Laborers' Union. Now, you're not just men who labor.
No, we're the guys that put all the concrete in place. We vibrate it. In some cases, we finish it. All the ALRT beams were built entirely by laborers. We did the ironwork, we did the rebar, poured the concrete, did the carpentry work, all of it.
Yeah, but it's conceivably, you could build a complete building by yourselves without any other trades.
Conceivably, we could, but that's not what we want, Jack. We want to go unified with the 17 trades and get into the residential
but
area.
But I get a message from you just now that there are many tradesmen out of work and desperate who would love to have a temporary membership in the laborers' union to work on a job at $12 an hour or more.
Sure, that beats starving.
And the other thing, of course, is there isn't any work in this. There's no union work being done in this area now of the wood frame construction.
99% is being done by the non-union. The other 1% is being done by the developers who have building trades agreements and cannot do it any other way but under union building trades contracts. Mm-hmm.
Let's see what people think about it. I may have missed a couple of questions, but I don't know. Go ahead, please.
Hello. I don't profess to know everything about the trade union situation, but I do know this, that if you find yourself unemployed, are you prepared to say, yes, I will work for $1.50 less, and then the next guy will say, well, I want to work harder than he will. I'll work for $1.50 less than him. And then it goes on and on. Are you prepared to start a trend like that? And how do you answer to it when you find yourself working for $4 an hour and labor represents only a certain percentage of the job?
Good question.
That's an excellent question, but the only fallacy is that what is happening to the unionized sector is that if we allow the non-union to keep growing, the unionized sector will be gone, and with it go the medical benefits, the pension benefits, and all the standards that have been built up over the years. You've got to go and try it. You can't stand in the corner and be a doubting Thomas.
In other words, you're going for a new area of employment at lesser wages, $12 and up, because you haven't got that work just now anyway.
That's correct, and I've got a surplus of unemployed.
Was it your idea or was it your membership's idea to go for this deal?
For 2 years I've been talking to my members and they've been telling me, for heaven's sakes, get me off the dole, get me off the welfare rolls, go out there and earn your money, do something.
Go ahead, please.
As an unemployed 602 worker, I fully applaud Rolly Gordon and the idea of the executive of 602. I rode my bike around yesterday and counted 17 sites, all 3 and 4 stories, all non-union. If Rolly and the rest of the trades can get it together, I, for one, say, go for it, boys. Let's have at it. I'm sick of sitting on my butt.
Thank you. Go ahead from Penticton.
Hello. I'd just like to congratulate this man. I think that he's finally a union leader who acts like a union leader. He's representing his membership, and if we had more men like him as union leaders, we'd get this province out of the position it's in, and if we had more men like him in Parliament, we'd have this province out of the position it's in.
That'll be enough of that.
Go ahead from Albany.
Yes, I'd just like to say, Jack, that I'd like to applaud Mr. Gordon for his actions in with the problems in the construction industry, and I'd sure like to see some more union leaders in this province take the same attitude.
Thank you. Go ahead, please.
Well, I finally a union leader that makes sense. I'll tell you, I'm an unemployed painter right now, and I would much rather work for $5 an hour, which is $800 a month, than the $375, which I am existing on right now. All the power to you, sir.
What's your union?
Painters.
Painters. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I just wanted to say, at last, a breath of fresh air and a voice of sanity, and it's so nice to see, and as others have said previously, I hope other union leaders are watching and listening and take heart, because there is common sense there, and that's what we need more of. Thank you.
Go ahead, please.
I'd just like to congratulate him. I'm a small businessman out in the Fraser Valley, and it's about time we saw something like this. Thanks very much.
Thank you. This is unbelievable, isn't it?
Yeah, it sounds like a paid commercial.
It seems that you struck the right nerve at the right time. Go ahead, please.
Hello, I just think that they're going about this in a completely wrong way. I'm from the Carpenters Union, Local 452. And for one union to go out by itself and start this kind of thing...
Well, I'm not doing that.
...not the proper way to do it, because the next thing you're going to know, you're going to have them all split up again, like they were 10 years ago before you had the building council.
Ask them about Brotherhood Construction.
Just a minute. You're saying, what is Brotherhood Construction you were talking about?
I understand that Local 452 has formed a company called Brotherhood Construction, where all the carpenters will work at a base rate of $15 an hour, of which $3 an hour would go to the union, leaving the carpenter himself at $12 an hour. And they have these set up in quite a number of their locals throughout the province.
So in other words, they haven't talked much about it. The Carpenters Union, therefore, must be split in two over its attitude to you.
Yeah.
Do you know about Brotherhood Construction, caller?
No, I don't. I haven't heard about that, but...
just to answer the caller's question, I want all the trades to come with us. And I guess what I'm doing is kind of kick-starting a few of them to get it done, because as a group, you're right, we're going to do better. But somebody's got to go out and do it.
Yes.
Go ahead, please.
Yeah, just another friend to say I congratulate Rolly on what he's doing, and I hope that he doesn't back down. We'd certainly have to say that at this point in time, with the economic stand, he's done the very best for his members and anybody else who will become part of the union trade.
Thank you. There was one thing I want to clear with you. You said that you weren't going to implement this instantly. One, you've got to get a
referendum ballot.
Referendum ballot.
That's 3 weeks to a month.
And after that, you're going to stand by and see if the Building Trades Council comes to you.
Well, not comes to me, but gets back in with the CLRA and negotiates an industry-wide agreement for residential construction.
Residential and wood frame construction.
That's correct.
Are they presently negotiating with the CLRA?
No, it broke off, and that's why I got very upset.
Oh, so, because I remember talk of that. That broke off, so you went in and finished your deal.
Yeah, that's right.
Go ahead, please.
Hello?
Yeah.
Keep up the good work, Rolly, and I bet the people in Nanaimo wish their union would have pulled out the same kind of deal. And I was just wondering about how's the setup on overtime wages, like at these rates, how will overtime work out? I'm gonna hang up. Thanks a lot.
Overtime will be at time and a half, but if you get rained out on a Wednesday, you're gonna work voluntarily on a Saturday at straight time rates. Double time rates will apply on holidays and on Sunday.
That's better than non-union, which don't have any of these rates.
The non-union works 7 days a week at straight time.
Do you think that you can get, that contractors can get work on this 602 agreement for wood frame and residential?
The contractors are indicating to us, and our check of what they're telling us indicates, Jack, that yes, they can. They can be competitive.
Go ahead, please.
Hello. Gord.
Good morning.
Good morning. I would like to talk to Gord. Like, I'm with 602, and I think it's about time that the wages went down, not only on the wood structures, even on the high rises. Like, I was driving around West Vancouver, and there's Sun Valley, and it has two high rises up there. There's 16 floors, and it's masonry.
Yeah. There's no argument. The last big $4.30 an hour increase we took 3 years ago did hurt us.
You got $4.30 3 years ago, just before the collapse of the economy.
Yeah.
And that must have put a hell of a lot of union people
it
into
did.
Business.
Put a lot of companies out of business.
Okay. Well, I think we've explored this fairly well this morning. You have signed the agreement with CLRA. $12 is the minimum. $1.35 in fringe benefits. Holiday pay cut, but the work week up to 40 hours with the money.
Yeah.
A good contract, you say?
Good for that industry.
Domestic residential wood frame.
That's correct.
You'll have your mail ballot back in 3 weeks, and then you'll stand by to see if the Building Trades Council makes a deal, and if it doesn't, you'll go ahead.
That's correct. But I am going to be in there with the Building Trades Council. I sit on that committee, and I intend to push hard to see that everybody gets involved.
My thanks to Rolly Gordon. We'll be following this up with Roy Gauthier, or whoever wants to speak from the Carpenters Union or the Building Trades Council, as soon as we can. I'll be back after the break. It's Ripley's Believe It or Not time. A man in one house gets his mail delivered in North Vancouver. The man in the next house doesn't get it delivered. Mark Schneider, intrepid, fearless reporter, investigates the man's complaint.
Despite the bridge traffic, most North Vancouverites like where they live just fine. They have a lot of the same conveniences as in Vancouver, such as regular mail delivery, without the congestion of the big city. These people on the 4600 block of Woodrow expect regular mail delivery and get it. But not half a block away, on the very same street, the fellow in this house doesn't get his mail delivered. He's been told if he wants his mail, he's got to pick it up himself.
Hi. Hi. Danny Keeble.
Yes.
You're the one who wrote us this letter, is that right?
Yes, that's correct.
I see you've written to the postmaster, your MP Chuck Cook, the Sun, the province, Jack Webster. Have you gotten any satisfaction from this yet?
None at all.
Well, let's start at the beginning. How long have you been in this house, first of all? It looks fairly new.
1st of December.
So you've been in here just a month and a half, about.
Yes.
And when did you first notice that you were having problems?
After about the first 10 days.
10 days, what happened?
Yeah. We weren't getting any mail. So we went to the local...
Well, you put a change of address notification
yes,
in.
Yes. So I went down to the local letter carrier depot at Mountain Highway and found all our mail was being redirected to the builder.
To the builder?
Yes.
Convenient.
Yes.
So you told him, you straightened him out.
I said I didn't think they should redirect my mail without my permission, whereupon they told us that there was no delivery to this subdivision.
No delivery?
None whatsoever.
So did your builder ever tell you you'd have that problem?
No.
I see right behind you, as I just came in, that he's conveniently given you a mail slot.
And it's within the specified distance from the sidewalk.
So it's all according to code?
Yes.
But no mail?
No.
So is there a solution? What have the post office people told you?
We have to have our mail address general delivery.
General delivery?
General delivery.
And that's the only thing that you can do? And where do you have to go to pick it up?
We have to pick it up at the bottom of Mountain Highway between 8:30 and 3:30 when my wife and I are both at work.
That's convenient.
Yes.
I find it incredible that a new development just a couple feet away, well, maybe 100 yards away from current services, is not getting mail. And is that what you're doing right now? You're having to go down and get mail addressed general delivery?
Well, we're refusing to do it. We're getting it delivered to this address. The post office themselves sent us a letter to this address.
You're kidding.
No.
Do you have a copy?
Yes.
Can I see that?
Yes.
They've addressed... Let's see this.
They addressed the...
Keeble, 4749 Woodrow Crescent. That's this place here.
Yes.
From the post office. They don't even know what they're doing, do they?
But they didn't deliver it. I had to pick it up.
So is there any solution? Have you heard of any solution? What about those group boxes?
We asked about that, and their policy is not to install them anymore.
No more group boxes?
Nope.
No letter carrier delivery?
Nope.
Unfortunately, you're stuck with general delivery right in North Vancouver.
That's correct.
Okay. I wonder what the union has to say about this.
I didn't know.
The union happens to be in the neighborhood to check out the situation firsthand. In these days of restraint, new homes could mean more jobs for posties.
Now, if I understand right, these houses right over here are presently being delivered by your members. Is that right?
Yes, that's right.
Absolutely. Right over here.
Right here.
And yet, these houses here, that house and this house here...
They're out of delivery. Mr. Corkery has dictated that these houses were not... were an extension and not contiguous to the North Van area.
First of all, tell me who Mr. Corkery is.
Oh, he's no longer with the post office, but he was one of the directors... we made this order some...
Well, maybe somebody else who's got his job now is going to be a bit smarter.
We'd hope so, but it doesn't appear to be.
Well, tell me, what kind of representations have you made to the post office?
We've made representation before our national executive because we were certainly concerned about the policy dealing with contiguous and non-contiguous areas. We understand what non-contiguous areas and contiguous.
Well, why don't you define what contiguous is?
Well, contiguous is within the postal boundary. A non-contiguous area would be an area where you have a block of land and maybe a development would take place, say, 10 miles up there. We understand that. But where we think there's an extension on a contiguous area, we think that these people here are entitled to the mail service.
In other words, what you're saying, let me see if I can interpret this. These people here are presently getting mail delivered by letter carriers.
That's right.
100 yards away... These people are not, you're saying that they're part of the same property, that they deserve the same service.
That came out in 1978, absolutely. And we weren't aware of it until about 3 weeks ago. And we've been fighting, within the divisional level to say, we don't agree with that policy. We think that these people are entitled to mail service, and they shouldn't have to go down to general delivery to pick it up.
Now, you mean for 5 years that this has been the policy?
We just found out.
Well, it hasn't been applied
in Vancouver. Sounds like you guys applied.
It hasn't been applied in Vancouver. This is a first in Vancouver.
Let's get one thing clear. Your union representatives for the letter carrier union, your main concern is not whether these people get their mail delivered, but it's that your members get work,
right? Don't get us wrong. We may be selfish, but we're not greedy. We are concerned about those people, but we also are concerned about the welfare of our own people and maintaining our jobs and providing a service to the public. That we're interested in.
So what's going to happen? What are you going to do?
We're only here by accident today, and you're aware of that. We didn't know you'd be here. But we intend to make a representation through our normal channels, which is with the post office locally, and then via Ottawa. And hopefully we can be successful.
You tell me, who do I talk to in Vancouver?
I would suggest you talk to Mr. Prescott.
Mr. Prescott?
Or Mr. Curry.
Or Mr. Curry.
One of the two.
Jack, I think that's what we'll do. Ran into these guys down here accidentally. I'm going to go downtown and see what the big boys at the post office have to say about this crazy situation. Mr. Keeble cannot get mail. He's been to the people at North Vancouver Post Office. They say he has to get general delivery mail.
Yes, he receives his mail at general delivery, North Van Post Office.
Let me get one thing straight first, okay? You're the guy who's responsible to say who gets mail and who doesn't?
I'm responsible, correct.
And you've said these people here won't get mail delivered?
Not at this time. We're taking the matter up in Ottawa.
Even though right across the street they get mail delivered?
That's correct. Any home that's built on the existing streets traversed by a letter carrier will receive mail. But if you build a home beyond the area currently delivered by letter carrier, then you become a special circumstance.
So if you build on an empty lot in the middle of two homes which are currently getting mail delivery, that's okay.
That's
but
fine.
If you happen to build on the end, then you're out of luck, is what you're saying.
Then you may be out of luck.
That does not seem logical.
Mr. Keeble's special circumstance, we're referring to Ottawa, but that is our policy at this time. There's been a freeze.
On how long? Since when?
Well, the freeze has been in existence for some time.
So when will we find out whether the people in Ottawa say, yes, we'll deliver mail to Mr. Keeble?
In 2 weeks.
2 weeks' time.
2 weeks' time.
We come back and we find out whether Mr. Keeble gets his mail delivered.
Right.
Okay, we'll check up.
And we'll check every week, in 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, 5 weeks, 6 weeks, 7 weeks, 8 weeks, 9 weeks, 10 weeks, 11 weeks, 12 weeks, to see if Mr. Keeble ever gets mail delivery after the break. What gives now with Expo in 85? Tomorrow we're going to have a bash at Mike Bartlett, the president of Expo. And a big crisis in the medical profession. The provincial government has put the hammer down on the doctors, it seems. Jerry Stewart, president, BCMA. With Webster, tomorrow at 9 a.m. precisely. Pat Carney on gas prices on Check with Webster at midnight.